Okay?
We just simply learn about forecasting from simple AR1 class. Okay? So think of sigma square E and for all k not equal to 0. So we have, what do you call such ET terms? White noise. So you have a white noise, right? ET is a white noise term. Okay. First, I can think of two things. We learned that if you have a stationary process, if you have a stationary AR process, AR1 process, a stationary process has a well-defined mean and it comes back, and we said that the impulse response function, how long the shock lasts, a shock will, the current period impact of the shock will be 1, the next period impact of the shock will be 5, the impact of the shock 2 periods later will be 5 square, 5 cube, etc, etc. So if phi is small, the impact of the shocks will wear out and the process will come back to its mean. Right? So a stationary process will be close to its mean most of the time. If it stays away from its mean, the impact of the shock will wear out because phi is less than 1 absolute value, it will reestablish its mean. So one way of thinking about forecast is to think of the mean value as the forecast. Right? Mean value as the forecast. To say, because the process will come back to its mean. If there's a shock, it will stay away from the mean for a long time, but it will come back to its mean. Right? And therefore we can say that the forecast for the process is the mean of the process. One way of forecasting the value of the process tomorrow is to say that the mean is a forecast for tomorrow. Is this clear? Right? Sure, so expectation YP is a forecast. It could be a forecast. Because for a stationary process, it will come back to its mean. It will not stay away from its mean for a long time because the impact of a shock dies out over time. Right? Okay? So, one way of forecasting this would be to say that my forecast is really alpha upon 1 minus phi. Right? The mean is a forecast. Okay, so if you have a time series forecast, so which you know is an AR1 process, you did all that identification, you put this onto a computer, ask the computer to estimate alpha and phi for you, the computer estimated alpha and phi for you, alpha turned out to be 2, phi turned out to be 0.5. So if your process was 2 plus 0.5 by t minus 1 plus et, what do you think will be the forecast for yt plus 1, yt? What is the forecast of IT? 4. So it's the forecast of IT is 4. What is the forecast of IT plus 1? 4. Forecast of IT plus 2? 4. Right? So you can say that the 4 is my forecast for all time to come. I know that each time period the process will deviate from 4, but that will deviate from 4 by randomly, set of terms, right? And therefore, therefore forecast could be a forecast, that could be a way of forecasting the process. Okay, that could be a way of forecasting the process. Sure? Is this clear? Okay. Now, so one way of thinking of the forecast from an AR1 process is to think of the forecast as forecast at time t, which I will write as ft, as expectation yt. Right? Okay? So what we are saying is yt is equal to, we already know that we actually can write yt like this. We can write it like this. Right? Now this is our forecast. So what we are saying, yt is equal to my forecast plus a random shock et plus phi et minus 1 So now think of FT as, so YT is the actual value, FT is my forecast. So what is my forecast error? The actual minus the forecast, that is the forecast error, right? So if I write my forecast error, YT minus FT, which is equal to what? Is equal to ET plus 5 ET minus 1. And so on. Okay? Yeah? So what do you think will be the expected value of my forecast error? Zero. Because I'll get expectation YT minus FT is expectation ET It says on an average my forecast error is zero, which means on an average I will be correct. See, if I say that the value for the YT tomorrow is 4, day after tomorrow is 4, after that is 4, after that is 4, if I take a sufficiently long period, the average value of YT will actually be equal to 4 and my forecast error on an average will be zero. So on an average I will be correct. Okay? I mean, it's actually a trivial conclusion here because I'm using the average value of YT as a forecast. So I'm saying if I'm using the average value of YT as a forecast, I have to be correct on an average. Right? Isn't it? It's simply a trivial kind of a statement that on average I'll be correct because I'm actually using the average value of Y as a forecast. So if I'm using the average value of something as a forecast, I have to be correct on an average. Right? Because that is the value that the system will take on an average. Right? But we like to call this in very nice terms saying that our forecasts are unbiased. Right? Our forecasts are unbiased. That is, on average we are correct. But our unbiasedness here just makes us feel good. Actually, it's just a simple statement that because we are using the average value of YT as a forecast, on an average we will be correct. That's what we are saying. So we are not particularly thrilled about this unbiasedness idea. My forecasts are unbiased, so what? What I'm interested in, how far away each individual YT will be from my forecasted value. How inaccurate I will be in each particular time period. Right? Okay. Now please remember one thing. Because all the error terms are normally distributed, my forecast, my YT is also normally distributed. Because YT is alpha plus some constant plus a normally distributed term into another normally distributed term, etc. So my YTs are normally distributed. Right? If my YT is now, what this is saying is, my YT is equal to alpha upon 1 minus pi plus ET plus 5 ET minus 1 plus 5 cube ET minus 3 plus 5 raised to 4 ET minus 4 5 raised to 8 ET minus 8, so on. This is YT, this is really expectation Y, which is the forecast. Right? I can say from this, that YT minus expectation YT is this whole thing. Right? YT minus expectation YT is ET plus 5 ET minus 1 So if I have to find the variance of YT, I must take the expectation of this square, right? Which is taking expectation of this infinitely many square like this. Sure? That will be the variance of YT. I know the mean of YT, I need to know the variance of YT. I know the mean of YT is alpha upon 1 minus pi, which is my forecast. So YT is normally distributed with the mean as my forecast. My forecast has the mean and the variance. I have to find what the variance is. The variance will be the variance of this plus 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 plus etc. plus the covariances which you have conveniently assumed to be zero. So then I will get variance of yp is something, now something very familiar will emerge. Variance of yp is equal to sigma square e plus phi square sigma square e. This part will phi ep minus will become its variance will be phi square sigma square e plus phi square sigma square e plus phi cube square sigma square e plus phi j square sigma square e and so on ad infinitum, right? Which can be written as 1 plus phi square plus phi square square plus phi square cube, phi cube square is nothing but the phi square cube we saw in the last time, plus phi square j and so on. Sure? The value of phi is less than 1 in absolute terms. So this becomes, so this converges to, this converges to sigma square into 1 minus phi square. Right? Sure? Okay, now, so what have we established from all this? We have established the following from all this. From all this we have established the following. We have shown that yp will be normally distributed with alpha upon 1 minus phi, which is nothing but the forecast at time t, right? And variance will be 1 minus phi square. From which it follows that yp minus ft, yeah, what is the distribution of yp minus ft upon square root of sigma square e upon 1 minus phi square? Standard normal, because it's a normalistic random variable minus its mean divided by the standard deviation is a standard normal, from which it follows that 0.95 is the probability, right, that this quantity will lie between minus 1.96 plus 1.96. Yeah? Sure? Right, folks? From which I can rewrite this as this term,
yeah.
This very simple really. From which I can write this as 0.95 is the probability, okay, that FP forecast, I know yt will not be equal to ft, the actual y will not be equal to ft, but this says that the actual value of yt will lie in the interval ft minus 1.96 into this quantity and ft plus 1.96 into this quantity. So around